During my work as a doctor, I came across various health problems which were all related to environment. We had a small typhoid epidemic 8 years ago, 9 years ago, which was definitely triggered by the dumping of municipal garbage from Pondicherry on our cashew fields or near the cashew fields out here in the countryside. I wanted to offer the farmers who say they need compost, they need raw materials for composting and they don't have enough cattle manure. I wanted to offer them a good quality organic compost with good biodegradable raw materials and not mixed municipal waste. I tried and I did not succeed as it is true what they say, there is not enough biomass around one village to produce enough compost. That is why they go to the to town and bring waste, garbage. And in my talks to the farmers, I realized it's only one big problem, the municipal garbage used as compost. The other big problem is the pesticide spraying. And it is a problem. It is a problem insofar as they do it in a rather indiscriminate fashion. They go to the shop to buy pesticides, as many patients go to the dispensary to buy a painkiller. You just state your complaint and you get something over the counter. You say you have a common cold and the pharmacist might just give you an antibiotic, which doesn't make sense, but it makes money. So it is a highly irrational and indiscriminate use of pesticides. But I do not even want to propagate a more discriminate and more rational way of using pesticides. I would rather drop it completely because there is no pesticides which is not toxic. Pesticides by definition are poisons and poisons to all life forms. So all this sophisticated academic arguing that this has a shorter half-life and this a longer half-life and this does damage only here and this does damage only there. This is, in reality, it doesn't count very much. If we are all flooded with a leak of pesticides in our foods, we all will suffer from it. And it would be good to have no need for pesticides, which is, of course is not in the favor of the producers, of the chemical industries. But it would be in favor of all consumers, of all customers, to eat food without toxins, or as little as possible. You see, this question about the impact on health comes always up, and people want to have proofs. Down to earth,
after the Green Revolution.
Down to earth, just 2 months ago, published an article on the impact of endosulfan in one village or in a few villages in Kerala. This is devastating, the impact of endosulfan. So this is a proof of the damage of endosulfan. Even this is not yet admitted by the scientists because they say it is not yet clear enough, it might be other things. But after all, they have patients with blood levels of endosulfan which are 100 times as high as permissible levels in food. And this is circulating through the blood, that toxin. And still there are doubts, it is not clear enough, say the scientists, or says the corporation, the cashew promotion corporation, whatever that is. After this article, the recommendation to use endosulfan was withdrawn within a few weeks. But the same letter which withdrew this recommendation stated, we are not yet saying that this, what the endosulfan article in Down to Earth is telling, is the truth about endosulfan or not. No statement in regard to this. Even if the same people will say after half a year, 1 year, 2 years, endosulfan has produced all this damage, what does it mean to the organic, to the farming scenario? Nothing. Because you withdraw a recommendation for one pesticide, you have 5 other substitutes. So what are we waiting for? For another village to demonstrate the devastating damage after 20, 30 years of the next pesticide. And then the next, and then the next. I would just not use them at all. Then we have all the arguments of the mainstream so-called agricultural science and the mainstream industrial world that we cannot do without pesticide. Maybe we cannot do without any pesticide at all, but we definitely could do on this globe with a fraction, a minimal fraction, which of course means no business to the industrial companies. Then the business is gone. They want to expand, they don't want to go back. So asking for a health impact, I have seen only, as a doctor, I have seen only self-limiting, short, acute poisoning appearances, which are harmless. Yes, you feel bad for 2 days, you have tearing eyes and a running nose and a bit of difficult breathing. And after 3 days it's over and the farmers say, that's part of the game. And the local people who do the spraying in the field, they say, that's part of the game. That's why they get a bit more money. They get quite a lot of more money. It's the best paid job in farming, is spraying the poison. But they know it's poison. They demand more money, they get more money, they get extra bonuses, they get an extra bottle of arak, whatsoever. They still go into the cashew fields with their children, with their wives, the small children sitting on the ground, in the spilling pesticide water, eating their food. Okay, you can't say this does a big damage after 1 day of practice like this, but at this for 30 years, you have a damage. Some hidden, slow developing diseases like a cancer, like a neurological disease, a skin problem. You will have lack of fertility or some miscarriages, some spontaneous abortions. How can you trace it back to the effect of the pesticide? You cannot. Only when you have a mass catastrophe like in the Kerala villages, then you can say, here, it's the pesticide. The pesticide is the strongest poison in this environment. It has a high level in the blood. This must be the culprit producing all these problems. Without such a community catastrophe, you cannot demonstrate. And you cannot, practically you cannot. You cannot ask for 100 volunteers to demonstrate over 30 years the damage of a pesticide. The stand of the advocates of chemical farming is highly unfair, I think. They want a proof that the pesticides are bad, and actually everybody knows they are poisons. It's only a question of limiting the toxicity. It is not getting rid of the toxicity. We want a toxin, we want a poison for life forms. That is the whole aim. It is a killing agent. It is nothing but a killing agent, and everybody knows it, and the farmers and even the spraying personnel, they all know it, because it is being used as an agent for suicide. They know this is a poison. If someone wants to commit a suicide, he takes a sip of a pesticide. Vermi-wash. So at the moment we use vermicompost only for vermi-wash. And the vermi-wash is being used as a pest repellent and as a fertility enhancer in this field, in this long strip of field. Wood chips. So that should have a little bit of a sweet sour smell like the M has. It has, yeah, the smell is there already. But it's also strongly from the from the cashew apple. It is not a ready compost, but it will have its impact because it has EM. The EM will, wherever you put it, it will go on, the EM microbes will go on using the unutilized organic material. So this is ready within a short time, ready to use.
அப்ப அவங்கெல்லாம் சாதாரண ஒப்பாதை ஊட்டுக்கண்ணா இருக்காது
அது வந்து அது தானாக வளர்ந்து தானே அது அதனால் அது அதை அழிச்சிட்டு வைக்கிறதுனாக்க
We have used the biodynamic preparations. We are using EM. EM is our main ingredient at the moment. But we are also using on a few plots only biodynamic inputs to see what makes us, what gives a stronger impact. We want to check the productivity and also the profitability of these techniques. So what I can show you is an overview of, we can walk along the main alley, the coconuts here. So they have picked already in the morning. They are picking every morning. Harvest looks good this year. Looks surprisingly good. Probably on the plots with an EM input, they are the best.
What's EM?
EM stands for effective microorganisms. I can show you, it's a liquid culture. In the back there we have old cashew nuts. Then you have younger ones, 4 year old, and then these last are 2 and 1 year old only. And behind the coconut alley in the back, there's another small tip of cashew tree. Yes. 5 rows of trees is about 1 acre. 1 acre is 4,000 square meters, or you can say 70. After one season, you should not make a conclusion, not draw any conclusions. But after 3 to 5 years, maybe we see already a difference emerging. Now, with a dry season, they all die down. Those which are drought resistant in their roots, at least they will come up with the rains again. Some will have to be sown fresh. We had 4 or 5 different ones. Crotalaria, Stylosantis, Dunham plants, which were this big, and they were grown in the same time as the neighbor had planted his Dunham. In the same week they were sown, and those were that big. They were well developed, but ours were just much bigger. And that was there, and those few square meters where the EM input had been the strongest. So obviously EM had made the difference. Now EM is not only a liquid, it comes as a liquid, but you can prepare various other inputs with it. For example, a mulch. We call it the bokashi, that's the Japanese word for a firm. To have a ground cover, and you will have the benefit of the EM microbes in the ground for the plant within a very short time. You will see the difference also within a very short time. The development of the healthy leaves will be very strong. Then you can prepare a pest repellent with EM. You mix EM with vinegar and an alcohol in a certain proportion. You spray it. It has a very convincing effect with a few soft-bodied pests. So we do not yet know against which varieties it would, against which species it would act, but the few we have seen, it acts very well. EM stands for effective microorganisms, and it's a liquid culture. A liquid culture of about 100 different microorganisms, 100 different species, including lactobacilli, such as they are in our curds, including yeasts, as they are used for bread, and including a variety of other organisms, fungi and yeasts also, yes. So these, the technological trick in the EM technology is that all these organisms seem to be able to survive in one culture. And this is Teruo Higa's achievement, to have created a culture which can support and transport 100 different microorganisms which actually need different conditions. So when we get in EM the stock solution from the Indian producer in Dehradun, then we activate this stock solution by feeding these dormant microbes with water and carbon, molasses or jaggery, any organic carbon-rich material, any sugar, the sugar. And when we have prepared this activated or extended EM, then we are ready to use it. Then it's living, generating, multiplying, thriving organisms ready to use. Then you can dilute the EM by 1 to 500 or 1 to 1000, up to 1 to 10,000. You can use it in the irrigation water, you can use it as a foliar spray. All these different recipes come into play then. And then, as I said, the advantage is that the farmer will see a difference within a few weeks of application. He will definitely see a stronger growth, he will see a healthier plant, he might see a difference in crop size, in crop development, in yield. We had here seen in one tapioca crop enormous big-sized tubers. There was no other input but EM. Absolutely, it's extremely cheap. It's extremely affordable. The producer in Dehradun gives it at a price onto the market which is absolutely fair. Every small farmer can use it. The problem is not the cost, the problem is the work. You have to have an interest and a motivation to use it appropriately and play around with all the different technical tricks and use them. So maybe there is a more in labor investment. But that depends on the farmer's interest in farming. If it is a little bit the style of the local cashew nut farmers, who are not so much into farming, but more into making maximum money with the least work, and not willing to really produce food crops for the local society, and they do not care very much where all these cashews go after all, with that attitude, you might not have enough motivation and wish to go into technologies, techniques, methods which need a bit more work. But a traditional farmer will happily take it up. Solution costs in India 115 rupees per liter, and you make something like 20 liters extended, activated solution from it, and those 20 liters which you then have for 115 rupees, you can dilute by 1,000, 5,000, 10,000. So with this 115 rupees, you go a long way. You can have 50,000 liters of EM. We have calculated once what it would cost to have a cashew field under EM. We calculate something like a rupee or less than a rupee per acre per year. No, per tree. We calculated something like, I think 40 paisa per tree we had calculated. But this all depends on how intensive you start, whether you do it weekly in the beginning or bi-week in the beginning, or you start very slowly, let's say once a month, you will have a slower impact. All this is possible. Nothing wrong about it. If you want to go full force, if you want to see a difference within 2 months, you should do it once a week. And it will be slightly more expensive, but the expenses, as I said, are at the level of a few paisa and rupees. So they are not the money is not the drawback. The expenses are not the problem. But then it would mean for the cashew farmer to go to the field once a week in a time where he usually would not even think about his cashew field. He would be able to tell any farmer, start like this, go ahead like this. I don't have the technical details ready on my tongue. I've understood the abstract principles, but I'm not dealing with the farm daily. So Margarita is doing all these preparations, the bokashi, the compost, mixing, diluting. She knows how to do that. Convert conventional farming into organic farming, because it is not a difficult package of practices. It's a rather simple and straightforward and affordable. So anybody who is open to organic farming, I would say EM is a great offer. We are also practicing biodynamic farming, which is much more complex. I appreciate it a lot, I like it a lot. But I would say explaining it to the local farmer and guiding him along through the years needs much more intellectual work than the practice of EM. And also the impact will not be that fast. You won't have a visible change within 4 weeks. Maybe even you have sometimes. Also depends a bit on the intensity. So even in one seasonal crops, in a crop of paddy over one season, you can see quite an impact. But of course, the longer you practice it over the years, the more convincing is the change in the soil structure and the change in the quality and the quantity of produce.